Okay, thank you for joining us tonight, everyone. At this time, we'll please stand and join us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, liberty, and justice for all.
We don't have a quorum.
We don't have a quorum yet, so we'll just wait. We got 5 minutes. So we're waiting for a board member who we expect to be here to open the public hearing for 909 Mass Ave and then for White's Woods. We expect him momentarily, so we're a couple minutes ahead of 6:35 anyway. So for the next 5 minutes, we're going to we need him for minutes approval as well.
Just sit tight.
Yeah, I guess he needs to hear anything we go through here. You don't have his phone number, do you?
Nope. No, I do not.
He thinks that because he's recusing himself that he's not going to show up to him.
I don't know.
Thank you.
problem. All right. So I'd like to, it's 6:35, and I'd like to open the meeting, and I'd like to open the public hearing for 909 Massachusetts Avenue. All right. So everybody should have a packet for 909 Mass Ave. Yeah, please come forward. Thank you. And before we get started, let me read the public hearing informational meeting notice. Thanks. Okay. All right, the notice. Sorry, I don't usually do this, so I'm going to be a little slow here. Okay. Public hearing. The Lunenburg Planning Board will hold a public hearing on September 22nd, 2014 at 6:35 p.m. Town Hall, 17 Main Street, Lunenburg, Mass. 01462. The public hearing will be to hear and discuss a special permit under Section 4.4.3 and a development plan review under Section 8.4 of the Protective Bylaw of the Town of Lunenburg for an in-home antique and consignment shop at 909 Massachusetts Avenue. Map 60, parcel 0003. Owner is Mary L. Padula, 909 Mass Ave, Lunenburg, Mass. Applicant is DJ Lay, 100 Lancaster Avenue, Lunenburg, Mass. Materials are available for viewing at the planning office, 960 Mass Ave, Lunenburg, Mass. 01462. All right. Thank you.
Hi. I own the antique consignment shop in the center of town, presently located at 3 Lancaster Avenue. And so our hope is that we have approval to use 909 Mass Avenue, 909 Mass Avenue for our shop and also to live there. So when I filled out the application, we were at 100 Lancaster Avenue, but we have since moved to 909 Mass Avenue.
Congratulations.
Thank you. So antique shops are a slow flow business. We never have more than 7 to 10 people in the shop at a time, you know, mostly like Saturdays, maybe Sundays would be the busiest. My hours that I'm asking for would be Wednesday through Saturday, 10 to 5. I'm thinking maybe Wednesday night. Jeffrey's is open Wednesday night till 8, and maybe we would also. And then Sundays, 10 to 5. And I would be closed on Mondays and Tuesdays. So I'd be able to do laundry and grocery shop and that kind of stuff. And so we have one daughter who's 16, and obviously she lives with us, and so she'd probably be helping in the shop, but we don't really have any employees, which is kind of why we wanted to have the shop where our house was. It would help to reduce expenses, and I would be, you know, have a couple days off and then work the shop the rest of the time myself. So I didn't know if you guys have any questions or...
Does anybody have any questions for
The sign that I have at 3 Lancaster would be the type of sign that I would want to use at 909 Mass Ave. And I would, you know, make sure that it's appropriate, not wild or, you know, antique shops are very traditional. So our sign would be very traditional. I think I've given you kind of a copy of what it would look like. We will change our name. The Harley House has never been outside the family in 200 years, and so for this opportunity, we feel that we should rename our business Harley House Decor, so that it always remains the Harley House in our lifetime. Do you want to talk about
that? The other thing is we noticed for the short time we've been there, even though there's an exit and an entrance, it wraps around the building. Most folks that are coming in are using the entrance close to where the building is, and they're weaving. But we feel like for the
business, even like the plumber, anybody who's had to come, you know, for the sewer commission.
Because of the sight lines, it's, you know, there's a lot of trees on one side of the property. There's a very wooded or overgrown area. There's a lot there. You really can't see the property or even that where they'd be exiting until you're pretty much on top of it, past it. We want to have an entrance And an exit that would, well, like a post would say entrance and exit for safety purposes, so people aren't getting hung up waiting for somebody to get out so they can get back into the property. So we want to have an entrance and an exit. The, you know, the driveway is already there. And we are hoping to have a flag, again, because of the sight lines and the fact that you really can't even see the building until you're on top of it. The flag would be on the same post for the entrance. There'd be a post, and it'd also be an exit with a post that would say, you know, would have a flag. It would help let people know that there's something there, or there's a business there.
Right,
but at the same time, it'll cause
approaching it.
Yeah, bring attention to the fact that there is a driveway there, and it does say exit or it does say entrance. So it'd be like a bookend for the front of the property.
And what I would like the signs to say, I think one would say consignment and the other one would say furniture. And I've brought an example of what the flags look like. This is, in particular, is an open flag, but it's the same company that makes them. So they're red, white, and blue, so they're not crazy or anything. And then down the center, it says open, but down the center, it would say either consignment or furniture. Just, I think, because so many people drive by that and just see it as a house or did see it as a restaurant, and the shop will be in the back where her restaurant was, and so there's no windows or anything that people could look into, like a shop, and see what it is. So I would like, you know, to be able to do that. And I know I'm allowed an open sign, and I would like to place the open sign at the door because there's so many entrances and exits to that building. We'd like to have the open flag by the door so people would know what door to come in.
Okay, thank you. Any questions from members of the board?
I have a question, actually. In your letter, you state that there's a maximum of 3 square feet in the
I wasn't sure. When I was told that I had to do this, I was told that I had to go before the zoning board again. So it was basically the same package that I had given the zoning board a year ago for 3 Lancaster. And what they had told me at the time was that residential properties could have a 3 foot sign, I guess 18 inches by 18 inches approximately, is what is allowed for a residential home. But that was, 3 Lancaster was zoned residential. But 909 Mass Ave is limited business. So I'm not 100% sure what the sign allowance is for a limited business. But when I talked to Marjorie about putting the proposal together, she said to go ahead and just use the one that I had used for the zoning board and just say that I wanted my sign to be the same as I have now, which is similar to other signs on the properties that are around me, and obviously much smaller than like what Conrad's has or Stone Farm, or, you know, so it's still, if you've ever been, if you look across the street and see the sign, it's not that big, and it's black and white, and it's tasteful. And
sure. Well, no, the point of the Conrad sign and all the others, well, I think all the other signs that you're referencing were in existence before the sign bylaw went through.
Okay.
And it is a difficult bylaw, and you are, it does say that you're allowed 9 square feet, but for a building sign. I honestly don't have a problem with it. I think that that it's good to make people aware, and it's better to have a bigger sign because people are driving and they don't want to squint.
Excuse me, I'm having a hard time.
Sorry, you're right. Yeah, I don't disagree with the necessity for a large sign on a busy road. It's difficult getting through this bylaw, in fact. But I just wanted to question how you'd put the 3 feet.
That was what they, that's what Lisa had told me at the zoning board.
Very good. Thank you.
I mean, I don't want anything neon or... I'm all about keeping it as historic and as beautiful. I mean, we just love living here. I love listening at the 0 o'clock, you know, listening to the bells ring, mm-hmm. you know, each hour. And So we're small town people, and we moved here for that reason. And
no, I think I'm good. I mean, the signs that you're asking for over the door are really on the side of the property. It's not like people are going to see it really from the street anyway.
So no, they wouldn't. And I just need to differentiate the door because there are so many doors. And, you know, I just want people to know where to come in. And
yep, makes sense.
So in all, are you going to only have one freestanding sign and one sign on the building itself?
Yes.
Okay. All right, so there'd be two signs altogether.
And that is what I asked for. Mm-hmm. For our present business, and I never ended up having a sign put on the building because people just knew what door to go to. So even if I just had a small, maybe a small sign that says entrance above the door, mm-hmm. that might suffice.
So yeah, let me see if I understand. So there's, I have a few questions. There's the sign on the door, that's the 18 by 18.
I probably wouldn't even make it that big. That is what you're allowed.
Okay.
So I had to keep referencing that for the zoning board because that's what they told me. But I just need a sign like above the door that says entrance so people know where to go.
Okay, no, that's fine. I'm just trying to make sure I understand the signs. And the other sign is the maximum you're proposing is 48 by 32. And that would be at the front of the property, like kind of where the Harley House sign is now.
Yeah, yeah. You would use the same post as the light there. We wouldn't move that post or anything.
Okay. And you mentioned some flags. Where were those going to be located?
Right where the driveway, there's two entrances, or you know, one would be an entrance and one would be an exit. Right there, we're going to put a post right where people would either enter or exit.
Actually is a post.
Yeah, there's already a couple posts right there. So we're just going to move them to the entrance and the exit. I don't know how long they've been on the property, but we're going to reuse those. They're painted white.
Okay.
They're the same style as the actual sign that would be held up.
I actually think it said entrance, but they took the sign.
So let me make sure I understand. So the flags, how, just out of curiosity, how high would those be? Like off?
They're probably about 4 feet high. The post that the flag would be on, the post seems to be about 4 feet high, I think.
Okay, and the flag kind of hangs down.
That's right. It would just be hanging out like that, just at an angle.
At an angle.
Okay. And so those, the two flags and the two signs, is there any other signage?
No.
Okay. So that, I just want to make sure I understood what you're talking about regarding the entryway and exitway. I was a little, so right now, as I understand it, there's a, like you said, a big loop around the property.
Yes.
You go in one way, you come out the other way.
Yes.
Are you proposing a change in traffic flow? Or
No, we want that because for safety's sake, I think there should be an entrance and an exit. But what we've found is people who have come onto the property say, like, we just had a plumber there. He went in and then came out the entrance. So we really just want people to understand.
It looks like a private drive. If you look at the road, it's on the edge of the other lot that's overgrown.
Yep.
It appears as this goes out back to some sort of cul-de-sac or something.
Okay.
People just don't really it's kind of like a little log road looking to it.
So you're talking about putting like entrance and exit signs? Is that the flags or is that some different signage?
I would just probably stencil on the side of the post entrance so people know.
Okay, that's fine. I'm just trying to.
Yeah, black lettering. The post is already white, maybe black lettering.
It had a sign. You can tell a sign was removed from the post that.
Gotcha. Well, whatever. Yeah.
These are our neighbors.
We just want to call attention to the fact that there are two entrances and then put a flag on them. So.
And one would say entrance and one would say.
Yeah,
that's it.
Just for safety reasons.
Yeah, that makes total sense. I just wanted to understand. I apologize. I wasn't sure if you were saying, oh, we're going to make one sign.
No, we just. I mean, we just want.
Okay.
Kids walk home from school and, you know, we just want everyone to be.
That's all the questions I have at this time as well. Shall we open it up to the public and take feedback from the public on this?
Well, I have another question, actually. Have you thought about, is the driveway paved? The entrance is and the exit is not?
The entrance is, the exit is not. It's a gravel.
I might inquire, is your inclination to put like maybe an arrow on the pavement? so that if people wanted to drive out the entrance, they might see that.
Oh, that's a good idea.
We could do that.
Or maybe a do not enter on the interior facing the building.
Sure. That would
improve
we'll
the safety.
Any of that.
Sure.
Anything that's helpful. Yeah, we would do that, certainly.
Excellent.
Okay, anything else, Damon?
No, I'm ready to hear from anyone from the public.
All right.
Anything to say.
Would anyone from the public like to... Yeah, sure. Stay close, and they may ask you to come up again. Thank you very much. Anyone from the public like to speak regarding this project as a proponent? Would anyone from the public like to speak regarding this project in a neutral capacity? Come on up.
Lois Filio, 919 Mass Ave. I can understand the need for an entrance and exit. Perfectly reasonable. I'm a little leery about the giant red, white, and blue flags that say what consignment on them?
Furniture.
Yeah. And the other one says consignment.
I was thinking consignment, but if you prefer antiques.
I don't know if I prefer one thing over the other. The giant flag is going on the 4 foot tall post. And that flag itself is almost 4 feet.
3 by 5, I think.
And then you were going to attach that to the 4 foot post? Okay. I don't know. I'm not sold with the idea of the large flags on the entrance and exit, but all in all, I support an antique shop next door to myself. That's all my questions.
Donna Cameron, 919 Mass Ave. I also am confused about the size of the flags on the post. When you're coming out the driveway, if they're that big, they could in fact be blowing so that it would interfere with traffic, I mean seeing the traffic. So I'm really thinking that might not be a good idea. I was wondering if there was an engineered development plan review done on this permit or issue. I believe that's necessary.
No, there has not been.
Is it going to be?
I don't believe so. It's getting changed to a lesser use, and the only change being proposed would be the signage.
I can barely hear you. I don't know if any of these mics work, or I need a hearing aid.
I do believe that at this time it's not being proposed since it's being changed to a lesser use and there's a signage change at this point.
The site has changed?
Only signage.
Oh, the signage.
Just signage is being proposed at this point. So I don't know if the board is contemplating doing any sort of peer review. I think that was something that you were going to talk about.
My understanding is we weren't going to go through a full site plan review because, like she's saying, it's a less intensive use than a bed and breakfast or a restaurant, so there'll be less people visiting the site. It won't have such an impact on the neighbors. There's no change to the amount of paving or anything else on site except for signage. So that's why we weren't having an engineered site plan review, because there's really no engineering going on.
But it is a change of use. But all right. Now, are you people planning to purchase the property?
Yes. Right now we're leasing it, but our long-term plan is to end up purchasing it.
But there is no time set?
No. We have a long-term lease right now, so we're there for the long haul. It's not a short-term endeavor.
Could you tell me how long the lease is?
4 years. Four years. With an option, so at some point, we'll just do that.
And where is the Holly House decor sign going to be?
In where her sign was, out front.
Oh, and where is your sign going to be?
That would be our sign.
All right, the one you have up at the center says right. What?
We won't be using that sign.
Oh, I thought you were going to.
We would change the name to Holly House Decor.
Oh, I thought you said you were going to use the same sign.
No, same size.
Oh, same size.
Yeah.
Well, I'm sorry, got to go see a hearing doctor after this.
I'm sure it was me.
Okay, so you're going to change the sign. but same size. Okay. And so are there going to be the board's findings and directives on this? Could I be sent a copy? Or because I was under the impression that it had to be owner-occupied to have a small business in Residence A. So that's why I thought that the development plan review needed to be done, but...
We are living there.
Yeah, I know, but owner-occupied owner.
I believe it's limited business, right?
Yeah, it's not residence.
That's correct.
So it's a limited business use, so...
So it can be rented to someone to run a business?
Yeah.
Okay. And will it be a... any kind of a planning copy of what's actually going to be in print that you could send me?
We will be doing findings and directives.
And you will send me one?
Yes. Could you just please state your name and address again?
Donna Cameron,
mm-hmm.
919 Mass Ave.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
And again, those flags, they're definitely too big, maybe a small flag, but I really feel that it would be detrimental to the traffic flow.
So yeah, if you before you head out there, Donna, just may we ask you a couple questions,
mm-hmm.
Just to understand a little bit better. You know, your concerns. You mentioned traffic flow. So regarding the flags, is a nearby resident? What is it about the flags that you're most concerned about? Is it impact on traffic lines?
Or is there traffic other? And size, because unless they're straight up and the wind's not blowing, because those posts aren't very high, so I'm just thinking, and again, I'm not saying it would look really, I don't know.
Can I add something?
Sure, absolutely.
In lieu of flags, I would almost rather see some sort of a wooden colonial sign, even allowing her a little bit bigger, if she wants to advertise furniture or consignment. I like the idea of a wooden colonial looking sign over a red, white, and blue flag. And a flag, if it says whatever it says on it that you want to advertise, if the wind's not blowing, I don't know if people are even going to see the word on the flag.
Well, it's just to actually...
You were going
to
hang it...
attention to the... that is, you know, to bookend freely the side of the property, so they will see... they might not be able to read it, but they will see the colors and then blow their eyes.
Yeah. Entrance, exit, consignment, furniture, I don't know. I just, the big red, white, and blue flag doesn't thrill me. That's all.
And where is the, you said you want them to know what entrance to go into? Is that going to be in the back, that entrance sign? You said you want them to know what door?
Yes, it would be on the side of the building.
On the back?
No, on the side of the building. It would just be a sign above the door that says entrance.
Where people used to enter the restaurant?
Oh, so that's where they're going to go in, not in the back?
No, not the back.
So right opposite my house?
Yes, on the side. And it would just be a simple sign, maybe white with black lettering that says entrance above the door.
Mm. And
it won't be big,
yeah.
You know, maybe, yeah. I don't know, like that big entrance.
I do agree with Mr. Allison that in the past the Holly House had entrance and exit, and absolutely positively no one followed it. So if you did put a sign, do not enter one way or whatever, facing the back, that might help.
Okay.
Because otherwise people just ignored it.
Okay.
And you're right, when you come out, the narrow driveway coming in between the way the land flows, it's kind of a hidden driveway, so
yes.
I think that's absolutely a great idea. I guess that's it. I would like to, any other questions?
Yeah, if you have a minute. So if the signs, so I understand, you know, aesthetically they may not be exactly what you would prefer. If they were set back in order to not interfere with traffic, though, that would address a portion of your concern, I guess, if I'm...
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
I don't know how far back, and I don't know, again, I kind of agree red, white, and blue lodge is kind of ostentatious. Are we going to, also, is there going to be outside display of items?
Yes, I did ask for that, just like I did from the zoning board. It's a very small area, maybe 3 feet by 5 feet, just enough to maybe put, like, two chairs
out front.
And a small table, and I'm not even sure that I would do it out front since I'm going to have to haul it in and out. And I can only do it in good weather. I can't do it when there's snow or if it's raining or anything like that. So
what did you approximate the size would be?
About 3 feet. I think we decided like 3 feet by 6 feet or 3 feet by 5 feet is what the zoning board had allowed me. It was enough for, say, like 2 chairs and a mm-hmm. small table in between or...
Okay, so just is this for all districts? So, under signage permitted in all districts, businesses are allowed by right one open flag, and that flag of no larger than 3x5 with only the word open on the flag. So that I just mentioned this just to give an idea, convey a flavor of what's allowed by right for any mm-hmm. business. What they're proposing is 2 such flags with different words than the word open.
But I believe all signage has to be at least 20 feet back from the road. That's what I remember.
Yeah, maybe. I don't know. I'd have to.
And again, the size was it wasn't 3x5. They're talking about an open flag, like on the porch, I'm assuming, when they say 3x5. I don't think a 3x5 can go out at the road.
That is what I'm allowed to have at 3 Lancaster. It is a flag just like that's a 3x5.
And how close to the road is it?
Most of the businesses in town have them. Pizza places.
You had it on the building, didn't you?
No.
Well,
it's
hanging by my door,
so it's a good.
But you're allowed to have it out.
But it's a good 20 feet from the road, correct?
Yes.
Yeah, and you want to put them on these little posts that are right by the road.
We would move the post into required
20 feet.
Yeah, wherever we're supposed to be.
Yeah, I don't know that I see the 20 foot requirement right now, but.
I see it.
Where you found it?
It's on page 6.5-4. It's the very top one. All signs shall be located on the building or at a minimum distance from the street line of 50% of the required front yard.
Okay, and that would be 20 feet in that district.
And that's not, just to clarify, that's not from the street. Oh, it is from the street line, which actually is the right of way, I believe, rather than the edge of pavement.
I don't know. Do you have any insight into where the street line would be?
The street line is usually in the center of the road.
That's the center line?
Yeah, the center line. Yeah, usually that's the center line.
Okay, so he thinks it's the right of way. You think it's the center line.
When we had the flower shop there, we had to put our sign. In fact, the Holly House moved their sign from where it was supposed to be closer to the road, and I always wanted to go measure it because I'm pretty sure that it. I don't think we want 3x5s close to the road.
All right. So I think
it further goes on to say that 1 per street number of signs.
One. Yeah. So if you wanted to have like open, you know, on the porch or even by where the Holly House decor, and I think the exit and entrance is great, but I'm not sure how to designate it without being a little bit over the top.
We feel like, well, obviously we definitely like the flag to call attention to there's a business there,
but right.
We feel with just them posting the exits on it, people are just flat out gonna miss that.
Well, if they see antiques,
attention to the post and what's on the post.
Right, but if the flag is here saying antiques and furniture, I doubt they're going to see the stencil exit and entrance when they didn't see it before. Because they're going to be looking for antiques and furniture, which is good, but.
Yeah, personally, I'm not sold on the flags either, and I would almost be more in favor of a wooden sign. Maybe could you maybe hang a sign from the porch or something like that? Some furniture.
Really? Well, I don't even know what kind of flowers they are. that there's a vine that grows on.
That's the trumpet vine. You have to keep working on that, or it'll take over your house.
Encapsulate yeah. the porch, so you can't even tell there is a porch.
Yeah, they had a gardener that pruned that all the
can't
time.
Can't hear you at home when unless you talk up here.
Oh, I'm sorry. Just both.
There's a vine that grows on the porch that's kind of completely taken over the porch, so you can't. There is a sign up on the porch that says 909 Mass Ave, and yet we still had the fire chief come and tell us to put 909 someplace where they could read it, because you can't see it because of this flower.
If you look at the front of the property, there's big sprawling trees all along the line, so it's very difficult for people to see that we have anything going on there. We do want to be successful. It has this nice busy road frontage, and just without drawing some attention, unless they're right on top of that one sign, we're clearly going to miss opportunities for people to see that we're there that don't know we're there. I mean, you know.
And if I can only have one sign out front, I could attach it to the post that will have our colonial sign as you're talking, but rather than have it say open, I would rather choose for it to say either antique or consignment or furniture, just because they may still think that it's a restaurant if they see an open sign in a place where there's been a restaurant for 15 years.
Would you be fine if instead of her one open sign, she used a furniture sign instead?
On the Holly House decor sign.
Yeah,
have a furniture sign there.
On the post. That would be further back.
The one where the grouping road. Of flowers are.
Yeah,
a grouping
yeah.
of shrubs.
Where
yes.
the post is right now.
Yeah, yeah.
Which nothing's on it right now. Nothing's
yeah.
hanging on it.
Where it used to say Holly House.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, that wouldn't bother me.
Okay. Because right now we're actually writing a village district bylaw, and next time we talk about it, we're going to talk about signage and how to still be appropriate to the area but be helpful to business owners. So it is something that we're aware of. It's difficult for business owners, but at the same time, we want to be responsible. So
right, and keep the village beautiful. It's the reason we want to be here.
Yeah. So there might be some more opportunities for you to... Then, when we think about this further, but right now, I mean, I'd be fine with the furniture sign instead of the open sign, and you're replacing her sign with your new sign.
Yes.
Yes.
And putting whatever sign over the entrance that's on the side of the building.
Yes.
I wouldn't have a problem with that, but I'd kind of still hold back on the flags for right now.
Okay. Would I be allowed to have an open sign at that door during open hours so people know when I'm open and when I'm closed?
I would say definitely.
Where is that going to be?
At the door. It would be just something
where it says entrance?
Yeah, I would just put it out when I open at 10 and take it in when I close at 5.
But it'll over be on the side where
yes.
it says entrance, not out front.
Not out
no.
front.
That sounds fine with me.
Yeah, I understand that to be an allowed use.
So, yeah, that was that in your original request? Was a sandwich board by your entrance or not?
I actually have not used a sandwich board.
Okay, I must have misread. Sorry.
I think you're allowed a sandwich board, but again, it's something that you'd have to haul in and out every day.
Yeah.
So
I'm sorry, we got to... So, where are we landing as far as signs go? We have the one freestanding sign where the Harley House sign is, which is with your business information, the Harley
House
decor.
We have the sign on the building where the entrance is.
An entrance.
And you would like an additional open sign.
Flag.
Also, flag.
Just
okay.
to be able to
yep.
put in and out.
That's on the easterly
sorry.
Side of the building.
On the easterly side.
So is that...
Thank you.
Where's that... part of the building I'm
missing. It's when you enter the entrance driveway, you would drive up past the house portion.
Okay.
And then there's a where the bar was, keep going, and then there's an entrance on the left.
Oh, so the flag's all the way back there, you're saying?
Yeah, that open sign, yeah.
That would be the open
same place flag. As they're putting the entrance sign.
That's the open flag.
Yeah.
Okay.
Open sign.
She just said flag.
Did I say
an open flag right out front?
She said open flag.
Yeah, but she's going to have a yeah, furniture
flag.
Going to
be another flag in the back that says open, or just a little sign that says open?
I would use a flag to just take in and out.
Okay.
In the front.
Okay, just so they're clear on that, right? The furniture flag is still going to be out front on the post?
Yeah.
Furniture flag would still be out front on the post. Is that, how many flags is that out that you're requesting in front? One flag out front.
In front, yeah.
I could even take like an old milk can and put my open sign. Doesn't have to be attached to the building, just so people, some people know if they drive in and see that, they know you're open, and if it's not there, you're closed. Just, you know.
And where would you put that?
On the east side.
But back? Would they even see it?
It would just be right at the door.
Okay. Yeah, that sounds reasonable.
So the flag in the front that says furniture, I'm sorry for being so
thick
about this.
That's okay, I know. Sorry.
It's on a post by... Where's that post located? I'm just trying
to... The post is where the Harley House sign is now.
Okay, so you're going to have the sign and the post would be over.
So we would put our sign there, and then we would just have, you know, a bracket to put the flag.
Okay. Okay, so in that works for you guys?
Fine.
Okay. And
we don't want unhappy neighbors.
No, I understand. Well, thanks for both of you for dealing with
it. And again, it is written that the outside displays will be like 6x10.
Not even that big.
Not even.
Trust me.
Because when I had the flower shop, I couldn't put flowers out front.
So so I just to expand upon, so I think we're pretty...
They wouldn't let me. It's a limited business.
So any comment on the proposed resolution to the signage issue for this?
The furniture flag is a deviation from the allowed use. My understanding of the interpretation by the zoning officer is that multiple uses allow for multiple signs. This is my understanding of how Chapdelaine's has those three huge signs. They've got new, they've got used, they've got repair. If you've got antiques and you've got furniture, my understanding of that interpretation would qualify you to have two signs. I don't believe that the enter sign on the side of your building, I don't think that we would have much authority over that at all, really. I mean, it's a sign on your building, on the side of the building. It's not on the front.
Yeah, I don't know if it's even on the building.
So, I mean, that's kind of a moot point in my mind. I'm not comfortable with the flag that says furniture. I am definitely in agreement with the potential resolution of having a colonial wooden, just a aesthetically pleasing wooden sign. And all in all, I think it's honestly, it's rather silly issue, but it needs to be taken care of. I agree.
What he's saying is he thinks it's silly.
Well, I think
for us to have to,
yeah.
it's a tough thing to determine.
You know, we have.
He's not saying your proposals.
No, no, not at all. No, we have to go by.
Silly, trying to figure this out.
I feel silly, right? I mean, this bylaw is very difficult to interpret in the first place, and then as far as the regulating it, that becomes difficult as well.
The restaurant had a red, white, and blue flag attached to their wooden restaurant sign.
And that said open.
And that said open. And that I do not find offensive just for the fact that it was set off the road a little bit.
Mm-hmm.
And the post that it was on was a taller post than the 4-foot post that they were originally suggesting. So the difference between what they want to do and what the restaurant was doing is the word on the sign.
Gotcha.
And also, if you're having this flag made up special, mm-hmm. maybe you could choose like a colonial colors and have reversed furniture and antiques in opposite colors, something maybe a little more softer and
okay. Please, I thought the red, white, and blue would be more like an American flag.
So yes, it is, but it's also harsh when it isn't got stars on it.
Okay.
You know, I was just thinking.
I think they probably make them in other colors.
Yep.
I just thought it would more blend in with.
Yeah. I don't know. I just.
Okay.
Pretty easy going.
Yeah.
Well, thanks for. So, Damon, do you have any other comments right now? I guess I'd kind of like to. We got another case to take. I wish we could spend more time. I think, you know, I guess I would propose that we. They've reached a pretty good agreement here. I guess I would propose that we put that. I mean, basically, I think we can look and see most of what she's requesting is probably within her right. I mean, in terms of signage, there is the difference, as she said, with the, it's a different lettering than what's allowed by right. Just to be clear, we have it as a, we're hoping to bring to town meeting a rewrite of our sign bylaw across all districts, as well as the village district bylaw change, which hopefully will make it easier and clearer to business owners and owners alike. One of the driving things behind that is business owners in Lunenburg are consistently complaining about the fact that our signage bylaw is very confusing and quite restrictive, and it makes it difficult for us to have vibrant small businesses in Lunenburg. And obviously, you know, it's a balance, but you know, with everything, but hopefully, you know, we'll be able to get something that'll clear this up, and it may have some things in it that are useful for your business, and it'll probably also contain things that are, you know, help us with some of these, provide better guidance, so that the things that are allowed, you know, it's not us three trying to figure out what makes sense here, but we've had some careful thought put into it, and you know, it might allow more things, but those more things might be things that people generally find, you know, more appealing as well, so.
Yeah, it is. It is very difficult, but it is Residence A, so we have to keep, that's the nutshell of the center problems.
Well, just for the record,
right,
I think
we're
going
to be living there too, so
yeah.
We don't want it to be ugly.
I'm pretty sure it is limited.
This is actually in limited business district, but it's very close to Residence A.
Yeah.
So thanks.
The front of my property is Residence A.
Yeah. The front is Residence A. So the front of yours is Residence A. It's kind of a weird line there between Residence A, and I think Harley House is actually in limited business, but I'd have to double check.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Do we know for sure? That would be a good thing to know for sure.
It is, because otherwise I'd be going before the zoning board again.
Zoning board again? Okay. All right. So, Damon, do you have anything you'd like to add to this before we move forward and maybe take a motion to approve the, or motion regarding the request?
Yeah, I'm ready to make a motion, I suppose.
Close the hearing first, then motion.
Okay, so
after comments.
Any final comments regarding the request for the Harley decor? All right. Well, thanks everybody for coming out today and informing us about the issues with the request, and also informing us about the desires related to the request. And so at this point, we're going to adjourn. Take a motion to adjourn the public hearing on this topic.
So moved.
Second.
And we'll move to discuss the we'll move to discuss it as a board. So thanks very much, everyone.
And I encourage everyone who's attended this hearing to go over there and put your name and address on the sign-in sheets.
Mine is at 7:30. Are you going to be back?
I'm sorry?
It's Sharon Graham. It's for 22 Oak Ridge Road in Lunenburg.
Oh, Sharon. Okay, so
yeah.
we're not closing the planning board meeting. We're just closing the part in the public. There's like a part where
They asked me to do the public, so I...
Sure. We just for Harley House, so we'll get to Oak Ridge in just a minute.
Oh, okay.
Sorry, I apologize, we're running a little behind schedule.
That's okay. That's fine.
Thanks for getting our attention on that. Okay, so should we move and then come back to this?
No, we close the public hearing. If you guys are ready to make a decision,
okay.
Development plan review and special permit. It's both.
Okay. So
are we granting waivers, or are we just...
That'll be in findings and directives.
Or is this just a directive?
And where is the plan review?
So why don't we do this? So I think... So first of all, are we... I have some notes here about the signage. I think the tape will show the details probably even more accurately than my notes. I guess at this point, I'd be interested in entertaining a motion to approve the request for special permit conditional on the signage based on the findings and directives that we're going to issue based on the discussion that we had at the public hearing.
I would move that we approve two signs that are allowable use for the two uses on the premises and the open flag.
Oh, okay, and the open flag in the back, and so how many signs do we got?
On the side.
So they got the, all right, so we got the entrance sign, the exit sign, which we may not even have to regulate. We got the open sign in the back, we got the sign by the entrance, we got the sign up front, and then we got the flag up front.
That says furniture.
That says furniture.
That's mounted on the post.
Shall we motion, are you, so are you, which of those are not included in your motion, I guess?
Well, I mean, the bylaw says that you're supposed to have only open on the sign, on the flag.
So. Right, so.
If it allows the same size sign.
Okay, that's fine. Sign, I'm just saying that, well, you know, I didn't write the bylaw and
I'm just asking you.
You guys can waive it if it's not a huge deal. Okay. So it's up to you guys.
That's fine.
So yeah, we'll essentially grant them a special permit for the sign.
Okay.
Or waive.
And you can waive that they can have something other than just open. On
okay.
The
yeah.
Is
well.
It, is that something?
That sounds good. So we'll waive that it has to say open.
That sounds good.
I understand there was a discussion regarding the color. I mean, I'll leave the discretion regarding the color to the applicant, as long as it's generally compatible with the spirit of the town bylaw. Is this what I was recommend? Does that, something like that, does that fit with your motion?
I didn't see anything stipulating colors. Only the words.
Only the words?
Only the words.
Okay.
Okay, yeah, I haven't memorized the whole thing, so I'm not sure. So regarding your motion, Matt, I'm sorry, so your motion is?
That we approve two allowable use signs for the two uses on the premises and the open flag.
Okay. But not the furniture flag.
That can be a second motion, can't it? Because it requires us to waive something.
Okay. So he has a motion. Does anyone want to second the motion?
Second.
Okay. Discussion. All right. Do we want to amend it? Do you any interest in amending that to contain the furniture flag and the entrance and exit signs? A motion to amend it to contain the furniture flag and the exit signs.
Second.
The furniture flag as at the proposed location. Yeah. Okay. So we have a motion and an amendment. First, let's vote on the motion. All in favor of Matt's motion regarding signage?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. On the amendment, all those in favor of the amendment?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, so I think we've got the signage down now for the special permit as a whole. Entertain a motion to approve the special permit for the...
And say development plan review.
And development plan review for the Harley House Decor project.
I didn't see any plans, so I'm not sure that that really is applicable.
For development plan review?
I mean, doesn't that insinuate there's a plan to review?
Oh, okay. Yeah, here it is.
Nothing's changed.
There is no location of signs. Yeah, nothing has changed.
Yeah, this
is the package. They have pictures. It's not shown on the plan, but
they did have pictures.
They want the pictures.
Okay. No, I would move the approval of the site plan review.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay. So I guess the next step is findings and directives.
Working on the findings and directives and getting that to future meeting.
Okay, I apologize to the audience that that took a little bit longer than we had allocated. So our next scheduled business today, it was supposed to be at 6:50. We're doing it at 7:25. Will be a public hearing regarding White's Woods, which I will open momentarily. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Good luck to you.
I'm looking for the announcement. Do you,
I have it right here.
You have it? Okay. I probably have it too. Okay. The Lindenberg Planning Board will hold a public hearing on September 22nd, 2014 at 6:50 p.m. at Town Hall, 17 Main Street, Lindenberg, Mass. 01462. The public hearing will be to hear and discuss a modification to a development plan review and special permit under Section 5.5, Planned Residential Area, of the Protective Bylaw of the Town of Lindenberg for 221 White Street, Map 75, Parcel 53. Owner applicant is RIW Realty Trust, John I. White Trustee, 13 Jacqueline Drive, Lindenberg, Mass. Materials are available for viewing at the Planning Office, 960 Massachusetts Avenue, Lindenberg, Massachusetts, 01462. And with that, motion to open the, accept, entertain a motion to open the public hearing.
So moved.
Second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. All right.
Good evening.
Good evening. Good evening.
My name is Larry Sabian. I'm with Hannigan Engineering, and I here, I'm here representing Jack White at the Whiteswoods condominium project, commonly referred to as Farmers Row Condominium. This is a planned residential development that was approved under special permit back in 2006. And then it was modified in June of 2013, the remaining four building, eight units, putting them into duplexes. What we have found in the last building, building six, was that it was constructed actually too close to the sideline of the roadway. The bylaw is to be basically 40-foot setback. We have 39.1. So we're asking for a modification of that setback. We're requesting a modification to 38 feet. Now, the board has modified these this before. They've modified the setbacks to property line from 50 to 30 feet in a, and again, in this planned residential development. They've modified the distance between the buildings from 50 to 30 feet. They've modified the driveway setbacks from 75 to 45 feet. So what we're asking for, again, is to have a modification of the front setback to 38 feet. In addition, the setback requirement is 100 feet from the center line of the road. The board waived that to 65 feet, and we're requesting that that get waived, again, less 2 feet, to 63 feet. I know that Mr. Hannigan has been before you before, and as should have a package to you to explain the situation. Also taking the opportunity to draw up these little plans that show the building in relation to where it was actually designed. The looks like the building had been flipped, mirrored image. And there you go. So if the board would like, here, in case the public wants to have a closer look, I've also have a blow up of it out front here, as we can see. The buildings that are shown in red are what has actually been constructed. This is at the end of the development. There'll be no further buildings, no further anything that's going to be happening here.
In which building are we looking
at? We're looking at building six, which is basically at the corner of Maysfield and Richards Road. If you were to,
it's this building. That building there? Okay.
This dimension turns out to be 39.1.
Okay.
Should be 40. These two buildings, or this unit, shall we say, was originally designed to be jogged in the opposite direction.
Gotcha.
And.
Okay.
All so, I can say was a builder's faux pas.
Well, All right, thank you. So, board discussion on the request? We've discussed this at a prior meeting with the engineer.
Yeah, well, from my recollection, we were ready to approve it back then until we had legal advice that we had to open a public hearing to hear from neighbors. So I'm still with, we should have approved it back then, but if there's anyone from the neighborhood who wants to talk, then I'd be happy to hear them.
Sure. Matt, anything before we open up for public discussion?
No, I've said my words about this.
Okay, so anyone in the public like to come and speak in a proponent of the modification request? Anyone like to from the public like to come up and speak in a neutral or opponent capacity? All right, seeing no public comment, do we close and then vote? Okay, so any other questions for the applicant today while he's here? Okay, well, basically, I mean, I would echo Damon's sentiment. We appreciate your coming to the public hearing, and we're going to vote on this momentarily. In the meantime, we're going to entertain a motion to close the public hearing portion of this.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, and with that, we close the public hearing for this modification request for White's Woods. I'd entertain a motion to approve the modification request, or I'd entertain a motion in relation to the modification request.
I'd make a motion to approve the modification request.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Sorry for the delay.
No problem. Thank you very much for your time.
No, thank you. Okay, next item on the agenda here is the Flat Hill Community Solar. It's not you, or is you? No, okay. So, please approach.
How's it going?
It's going well, thanks. So, are you representing the Flat Hill Community Solar?
I am, yeah. I'm Michael Conway. I live at 322 Flat Hill Road.
Okay, Michael. So, good news and bad news. First, good news is I want to thank you for coming out today to talk about this. The bad news is, unfortunately, we cannot have a quorum to do a public hearing in relation to your project today. One of our members we knew was going to be absent due to a personal reason. The other one we expected to be here, but he fell sick over the weekend, and we just found about 3:30 or 4 this afternoon. So I want to apologize to you and the public for not being able to conduct this public hearing today, but I'm basically going to have to open the public hearing and continue the public hearing, and that's pretty much all we're going to be able to do for this afternoon, and it will be rescheduled, and again, many apologies from the board for this. So, any comment or questions before I go and open the public hearing
and close,
close to continue? Yeah.
No, Marjorie gave me a heads up earlier this afternoon, so I knew that we weren't going to get around to it tonight, but I did want to show up just in case any of my neighbors came and I could speak candidly with them about any of their concerns. So, I don't think any of them are here. So, that being said, go ahead and open it and close it.
Okay, thank you, Michael. Thanks for understanding. So I would like to make a motion. Oh, I got to read it first. So one moment. I don't have the...
Oh, yeah.
Thank you. Sorry, Chantel.
We
Okay, so Town of Lunenburg public hearing. The Lunenburg Planning Board will hold a public hearing on September 22nd, 2014 at 7:05 p.m. Town Hall, 17 Main Street, Lunenburg, Mass. 01462. The public hearing will be to hear and discuss a special permit and development plan review under sections 415 and 84 of the protective bylaw of the Town of Lunenburg for construction of a 75 kilowatt ground mounted photovoltaic installation at 322 Flat Hill Road, map 087, parcel 0026. Applicant owner is Michael Conway of 322 Flat Hill Road, Lunenburg, Massachusetts. Materials are available for viewing at the Planning Office, 960 Massachusetts Avenue, Lunenburg, Massachusetts, 01462. I will entertain a motion to open this public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. I will entertain a motion to close this public hearing to be continued at a to-be-scheduled date. Do we want to schedule that now?
The next scheduled planning board meeting's at the end of October. So that would be up to you.
Okay.
You could do a date to be determined as well. And we can repost the continuation in town hall.
Okay, Michael, sorry to bother you again. What is your situation with respect to time and schedule on this?
I wouldn't say it's critically time sensitive, but the sooner the better for sure.
Okay.
Like the end of October would be a little bit disappointing. Understanding that it may not, it may take a meeting or two once it's, you know, really open to get through all the details.
Okay. Thanks for helping us with that. That's useful. All right. So we could either schedule a meeting for next week, which is not scheduled. It's last week in September, or we could open the public hearing in front of our housing production plan and village district. That's a pretty packed schedule on October 6th. I would propose that we schedule this for next Monday and deal with it, because our schedule for October is pretty ugly as it is.
Since Matt is recusing himself, and it's you and me again, I don't want to make a decision without the other two people who have to be here.
Mm-hmm.
That's a great point. Okay, so we'll let's schedule it TBD, and maybe we can ask have Marjorie reach out to Joanna and Ken and see what work, see if that'll work for them.
Okay.
Could we tentatively schedule it?
We might as well we'll offer it as a suggestion to them and see where that goes. I'd rather do that than get the wheels moving and the signs posting and people noticing and then cancel it. But let's see if they can resolve this tomorrow, basically.
Okay.
That'd be great. Okay, so entertain a motion to close the public hearing to be continued at a date to be determined shortly.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you, Michael.
Thank you.
Okay. We have an appointment at 7:30, which we're shockingly only 7 minutes late for now. Compared to some of the others, it's not too bad. Yeah, for Oak Ridge Road, Sharon Graham and Melissa and Matthew McCarthy and David Ross Associates.
Yes. Mike Martorella, David Ross Associates, professional land surveyor. This is Sharon Graham. What I'd like to do is if I could have that.
Sure.
What we're here tonight is to ask the board to endorse this A&R plan. We're hoping that the board will waive their normal 14-day period in this particular case. We're also asking for a waiver to the contour plan. The reason for the waiver for the contour plan is the lots are already existing. They have access. There's no issue with that. The whole purpose of the plan is simply there is a problem with a septic system that is built on one property that services the other. Jim Gariffi of the Board of Health has signed the planning board document. He states no issues, address the problem with the septic system at number 18. In the survey of this, it also came to light that a very tiny portion of the building on number 18 was over the lot line. So in order to rectify that, all the parties and the attorneys have agreed to convey that 35-foot square parcel around the building, and it's also shown at the top of the plan and a little bit of a detail. That's the whole purpose of the A&R endorsement, and that's why we're here tonight and asking if the board will endorse the plan. And there's also a pressing time issue from the standpoint that there is a closing.
On the 30th.
On the 30th on the Graham property. And all parties involved right now would like to be able to complete that transaction prior to the closing. Okay. I have with me the forms.
Asking for the waiver. In that letter, I asked for a waiver to the abutter list as well, as it was a time crunch. I wasn't sure I was going to be able to get that, but I do have that, so asking for that as a waiver. And then I have signed forms by each of the parties.
Thank you.
Is the one signed by Melissa McCarthy.
Okay.
And Shannon Rollins. I have several copies here each.
Thank you.
I used to do it.
All right.
I've got the plan with me as well as seven prints of it.
Okay, any questions for the applicant here? I just have one question. I think I know the answer to this, but I just want to confirm. So this plan is really all about, is it just about the concession of parcel A?
Yes.
So the septic easement is existing?
The septic easement will be put in place.
As part of this plan as well?
Yes.
Okay.
To rectify both problems.
Okay, thank you.
But the easement could be done without the planning board endorsement. It's the parcel A that we're seeking the endorsement for changing the lot line.
Okay. Okay, Chantel, does that make sense to you as far as the plan itself?
Yeah, that makes sense of what they're trying to do here. It's at this point, it's a judgment call on the board's part as to whether they want to endorse this or not tonight.
Okay. Any? So they're under time pressure regarding their sale. The extent of the change is before us is this creation of parcel A to put the corner of the house on the parcel of the owner of the house. Entertain motions relevant to this. If anyone
make a motion to grant the waivers requested to release them from the requirements of the contour map and also the waiting period. So grant those waivers as well as approve the A&R.
Second.
Okay. Any discussion?
A question for the surveyor.
Yes, ma'am.
My understanding of the planning board's purview of an A&R is only for frontage and lot size?
No, there's three mechanisms to record a plan in Massachusetts. One is to have a plan done with the surveyor's certificate on it that says these are the lines of existing ownership and no new and roads. That's just a survey of a piece of land, and I can put that certification on and it can be recorded at the Registry of Deeds. The next two, anytime a lot line changes or if there's a new road, we need to come in front of the planning board. If it's a new road, that's where subdivision approval comes into play. If we were trying to get lots approved, we're looking at frontage under the A&R. In this particular case, we're changing the lot line, so we do need a planning board endorsement, and that lot line change It's two lots that already exist. We're not creating any new lots. We're not changing frontages, and that's part of the reason the board has the planning board note, on the plan. From basically, you're saying doesn't require approval under the law, and now we have a mechanism to record the plan at the Registry of Deeds. Without the board's endorsement, we don't get to record the plan.
It's just that my understanding from Toby, when we had this discussion before, when it was on Sunset Lane, about making a non-conforming lot more non-conforming, and we were directed that approval of an A&R was only focused on lot frontage and lot area. Does anybody recall that?
I don't think you'd be making it more non-conforming.
Yeah, no, I definitely don't have a problem with this. I mean, it totally makes sense.
You do need to have an endorsement by the planning board to change a lot line. I can't, because the certification that I say under the 81X part of the subdivision control law says that no new lines, okay? So whenever there's a lot line change or any change in a lot line or any proposed lots, we have to come in front of you. And a lot of the reason when we come in front of you and we're changing a lot line and we're saying parcel A is not a building lot and it will be conveyed to adjoining land of, and basically that's what this plan is doing, is telling the board we're not creating lots, but we're asking for the endorsement that it's not a subdivision, so we have a mechanism to get the plan recorded at the Registry of Deeds.
Okay, and anything else?
Nope, ready to vote.
All right, all in favor of approving the plan here to create parcel A for conveyance?
And granting the waiver.
And granting the waivers, for the waiver as described, or sorry, all in favor of the motion as described by Damon earlier.
Aye.
Thank you.
Thank you. So I guess
I can put the plan over there if you guys have time to sign it.
If you're endorsing it tonight, you should probably sign it.
Yeah, we might as well.
Okay.
Do we have the Mylar markers?
I think so.
Okay, awesome. All right, let me see what it's on our agenda here. So we can do that before we move on to the rest of our agenda. You guys are the last people here tonight.
Okay. it was important.
Thanks for coming in.
Thank you.
All right, should we line up and do this?
Certainly.
What do we keep and what do we take?
I do believe
everything has to go to Margie, doesn't it?
It does. And they can come back and pick it up tomorrow. Marjorie left a note saying that.
Okay, great.
Send that to the
Yeah. So the complete packet, including the Mylar, still needs to be submitted for processing. So she still needs to send it to the other boards and departments. David Ross and Associates can pick it up from the office tomorrow for a filing at the Registry of Deeds. So you can pick this all up tomorrow.
Okay.
Okay?
Yeah.
All right.
I'll just roll it up then.
Okay.
That's fine.
All right.
Okay. Well, thank the board very much.
No, thank you for coming
in.
Good to see you.
Good to see you. Thank you.
Okay.
Leave it out. We'll sign it on the way out.
Yeah, we're going to sign that tonight.
Okay. I'll leave.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay. And the prints are.
Excellent. Thank you.
All right. Let me.
All right. So, minutes approval.
Do you have the letter that asked for the waivers?
Let me check. I probably do.
I'll want to put it back in this pile here. Okay, great. Thank you.
And do you need this back, Nathan?
Perfect.
It's probably in my packet. Thanks, though.
It's probably in my packet, too, then.
Your packet, too. All right. Okay, so let's do some minutes approval. I am entertaining motions to approve minutes for September 8th, 2014. You may recall they were emailed to you over the last week, and also for September 15th, 2014. And they're here if you need to refresh your memory.
Make a motion to approve the meeting minutes from 9:08 and 9:15.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Okay, great. I'll pass them around here. All right, great. So it's time for committee reports. Joanna, representing the MRPC, is not here today. Capital Planning, she also represents Sun. She is not here. School Building Committee, I represent us on that one. School Building Committee met, I think it was last week, and there is going to be a groundbreaking ceremony for the new school as part of the homecoming. And I think, so keep an eye out for that being advertised. I'm sure it'll be in the, I'm sure it's on the website for the school building committee, and it's probably on the, it may be in the ledger at some point, but I think I can tell you when it's going to be right now. It is going to be Saturday, October 18th at 1:15 p.m., and it's going to be at the site of it. The site for the ceremony is through the gate located at the north end of the parking lot between the high school and the TC Passios building. The event is being held in conjunction with a homecoming parade and festivities. So I think there's going to be a pile of dirt, some ceremonial shovels, some town officials, some state officials, hopefully a lot of people from the public, and the goal is to celebrate the beginning of the construction that's already begun, but symbolically celebrate the beginning of the construction of our new school, new high school. So come one, come all. That is the biggest thing I have right now from the school building committee.
Were you involved in any conversation about the property line, or is that just the school committee?
We did. There was some discussion about it. Anything specific? They're discussing the. Okay, so yeah, the topic is the property line in particular. If folks have seen the plan, there's a parking lot located on the east side, I think, of the TC Passios building that is part of the proposed high school project. And the issue that's being discussed is how and to what extent that could affect the possible creation of a separate parcel containing TC Passios for potential repurposing or resale. And so, yes, there was some discussion in relation to that. Probably not as much of a decision making capacity as might have happened on the school committee, though, I suspect.
Yeah, I'm asking because I wasn't at our building reuse committee because I was at a meeting for the planning board at the last meeting, but reading through the minutes, it seems like the school is putting off deciding on that property line until we make a village district bylaw because they somehow think that the setbacks affect them. Me reading through minutes and getting the information, I think we need to coordinate with them because I see no reason why they need to wait for the village district to do that.
To do what?
To decide for their property line is.
So you're referring to the school?
It seems like the school committee is waiting for us to make a village district bylaw before they make any decision. So I just think there needs to be some coordination between us and them because I don't see why they need to wait for that.
And honestly, I'm a little disappointed that it wasn't done before the school plan was approved.
Yeah. So whatever coordination needs to happen, I just feel like there's a gap right now. So if the planning board needs to get with the school committee, I feel like that needs to happen sooner rather than later.
So where's, so I guess as far as dependencies go here, like the building reuse committee is also waiting for the
property line.
They're also waiting for the village district bylaw as well. So,
kind of.
And I can understand why when you're creating a property line that involves a building and how far from it, you know, they've actually, okay, so you're firing my neurons now, refreshing my memories a little bit about some of the discussion. The school committee, I think, produced a map of the TC Passios building demonstrating what a 40-foot offset looks like from the TC Passios, from the boundary of the structure.
Okay.
And I I have it on my, I could probably dig it up on my phone right now. I don't know if you're that interested, but long story short is it covers a good chunk of that parking lot.
Okay.
As currently proposed. So, I get what you're saying. I mean, I'm not sure. So I think even if this lot line were a gating factor, I think the school building or the reuse committee is still waiting on the village district bylaw to do any is what they've told us is that they're waiting on the village district bylaw to do any meaningful marketing of the property anyways. So if it were resolved shortly thereafter, it probably, I don't know, this is my opinion.
For some reason, they believe our zoning method is going to affect what they do. I would like to understand what they think the consequences are.
Well, okay. So, for example, right now the offset is, I think, 40 feet. So
I don't, why? It's a side lot, if you're going to call it that.
Is it a side lot? It's right on a public way there.
It's not a public way. It's a driveway.
It's a driveway. Okay. Okay, so it would be 20 feet then?
So are they saying they want to keep that parking lot and maintain it for the school, or are they going to move it and build it somewhere else? These are the questions I want answered, and I feel like we should be in the same room with them.
With the school committee? Okay, so that would probably be a good thing for the building reuse committee to get in touch with the school committee about.
Well, no, they're waiting on us.
They're waiting on
District. The school committee is waiting on a village district.
No, well, okay. But I think, as you pointed out, the building reuse committee could meet with the school committee and start discussing.
They've been trying to do that, and now they're putting it on the planning board.
Okay, but they don't need to wait for us. They can start discussing different contingencies or what they would do.
I think they need to hear that from us. From my reading of the minutes, is they need to hear that from us.
Okay. What date were these minutes, just out of curiosity?
Our last meeting, last Monday.
Last Monday? I wonder if that was before or after the school. Well, when I next meet with the school building committee, I'll certainly let the school building committee know. But, you know, I think this is ultimately down to the school committee because they own, essentially.
Yeah, own why that can't parcel. We get in the same room with them?
So I would suggest working that with this building reuse committee. I mean, as a planning board member, I don't see why the school committee can't talk to the building reuse committee before the village district bylaw. They may even
want it's coming down to a zoning decision that we're making, not the building reuse committee. They're not making that.
I understand.
Talking about our setback for a bylaw we're going to write, I don't think the Building Reuse Committee is the right mechanism for that discussion.
No, okay. You're saying they wanted to get together to discuss what the parcel boundaries are.
The school committee, from my reading of the minutes, yep. I could be way off here, but they were saying that they're waiting for our new bylaw before they can draw a property line.
Okay.
I want to know what their concerns are as to what our bylaw would affect them.
Well, you know, for example, we've discussed changing even the side offset to as little as 5 feet. That would have a pretty big impact on where they could draw that property line.
I want to know what their goal is so we can work together. Are they trying to claim that property line should be 5 feet off the building there? Because I don't think that's good for the Passios building. It's good for reuse options.
Okay, it's that types of thoughts that you're having there, which is why I think the building reuse committee should talk to the school committee. Because you're the guys who care a lot about the functional aspects of that boundary, especially with respect to Passios. And they're the people who own the parcel, basically. So, yes, we're the group that's going to decide what the offset is. If you guys talk, you may even be able to provide some input that helps us get something that works better for the both committees. But I think it sounds like those committees that got to get together and agree on what that boundary is, they're the most specifically interested, more so than the planning board at this point, I would say.
Okay. That's all right. I'll follow up with Jamie and see where the conversation is going. But my feeling was that it was put on us as far as we're being the roadblock right now.
Well, look, we're going to do a village district bylaw that'll go to town meeting in the fall. It's not going to go to town meeting before the fall. We got a schedule. They're welcome to come to our meetings. We're talking about it, I think, on, you know, October 6th. We're talking more about the village district bylaw. You know, in our last meeting, we discussed side offsets as small as 5 feet.
We did.
So that might be. So I think that's probably the low end of where the side offsets are going to go. They you know, maybe we'll have a change. There'll be a change between where we discussed and the time it goes to town meeting. But it definitely sounds like the locus of discussion is, you know, what's acceptable to the Building Reuse Committee and what's acceptable to the school committee. And yes, this planning stuff and the village district bylaw and the offsets that result from that will be an issue or a constraint, but in some ways it might be better for those two groups to decide what they want based on various contingencies, because they can they may be able to influence our decision on what we do with the village district bylaw.
Okay, I'll coordinate some kind of communication.
Okay, and thanks for bringing that up. Sounds like an important issue to be resolved quickly. So is there any other resolution that you can think of? Like, what else might you propose to expedite that?
I just wanted to hear from the school what they were looking for.
Oh, yeah, the school committee, I'm not that clear exactly on what they're looking for, to be honest with you. They did talk a bit about, they've been investigating with the MSBA to what extent the contractual agreement with the MSBA and what their plan is affects what they can do. You know, for example, are they locked in now to that parking lot because it was on the plan that the MSBA approved? And my understanding of that conversation and what they found out is that they're not very locked in to that exact parking lot, even if it was built to that specification. It wouldn't handcuff them too much in terms of dealing with that parcel issue. You know, if they wanted to convey it to the school there'd be ways they could do that. But you should have that discussion with the school committee or someone who's been a little closer to that legal aspect. But that was my understanding of what they found out.
Right. All I was saying was I'm confused. I would like to be not confused. And I think the only way I'm going to get not confused is if I talk to someone from the school committee. Whether I do that with them in front of us or I go talk to someone from the school committee, I guess doesn't matter.
Yeah, well, the planning board, they can talk to us about it, but ultimately I think it's really about what does the school reuse committee think is best for the parcel and what does the school committee think is best for the school and the planning board. We could kind of look back and forth, but I don't know what I would add to that discussion as a planning board member.
All right.
But thanks for bringing it up. And please report back on how that turns out.
I will definitely.
All right, that was exciting agenda item, but important agenda item. All right, Open Space Ad Hoc Committee. I also represent us on that. I have not done anything yet in my capacity as a representative there because they have not met to my knowledge yet. However, I am very much looking forward to meeting with the Open Space Ad Hoc Committee. So no report there. Building Reuse Committee, Damon, anything else you'd like to report from them?
No, that was my only point.
Okay, Ken represents us with MJTC. He's not here. Agricultural Commission, Matt, anything to report from there?
Yes, they are very interested in having some input and discussion with us on the Village Center District bylaw that we're putting together. I'm sure that they would be more than interested in a group attendance at our October 6th meeting. My understanding was that they were going to put together a letter requesting inclusion on the discussion, but I don't really think that's a necessity. I mean, I think we could just, it is a public meeting, they can just go. Their major interest was inclusion of a public market, a space for a public market. It's actually MGL 40, section, chapter 40, section 10 for a public market, population over 10,000 people.
Can you explain a little bit more about that particular?
I'm not sure. Well, the reference is Mass General Law, chapter 40, and it's section 10, and that allows for a township of a population greater than 10,000 to provide for the town people a public market. That can also be used as a farmer's market, but it's a permanent location with infrastructure. It's got electric, it's got plumbing, it's got heat, it's got a roof, it's got, you know, potentially sides. And it certainly wouldn't need to be anything fancy, but it's something that they would like to discuss.
Okay. Thanks for, anything else from Ag Committee?
No.
All right. Well, yeah, I mean, they're certainly welcome to attend October 6th, and it's great to hear that they're, you know, thinking about what it means to the agriculture in Lunenburg. That's great. All right. New business development status, 909 Massachusetts Avenue. We discussed 322 Flat Hill. We discussed White Woods. We discussed update on definitive subdivision for 50 Elmwood Road. I think you may have received it by email. So they're crush, screening, and hauling out sand and gravel. That's from September 15th. And on September 9th, they were also crushing, screening, and hauling out sand and gravel.
Interesting. I have a comment on that.
What's that?
I have a comment on that.
Sure.
50 Elmwood. I'm not sure. It's not a scenic road designation, so there's no necessarily regulation on the street trees. But there have been at least two large diameter, excessive 2 foot diameter trees that have been cut. I noticed this last week. I'm not sure exactly when they were cut. And I'm not sure that we had any kind of a planting plan or any kind of a directive about street trees. I remember it was an issue.
Yeah, well, my recollection is anyway that I asked for a plan of trees to be removed and if anything could be saved. And they said due to the quantity of gravel being removed and the extreme grade changes, there was no hope for saving any trees.
Really?
Yeah.
Well, at least maybe there were parts that they were going to save on the Elmwood, I think, right?
I don't think so.
Don't think so?
No. They were going to replant trees.
Right. And we got that on the plan. We got directives that they would commit to planting trees as designated in their plan, yeah.
Okay. It looks like the trees that were removed were within the right-of-way of Elmwood Road.
Yeah, again, if it were a scenic road, maybe we could harp on that some more, which...
Not that I want to harp on it. I just wanted to point it out and for us to be aware of it.
But I think it's a reason for us, again, we talked about getting Northfield Road and Flat Hill Road designated as scenic roads, so I think that just highlights the point where if we had that mechanism, we could protect the right-of-way, trees in the right-of-way on those two roads.
Certainly.
That's a great point. Anything else related to Elmwood?
Thank you.
All right, thanks for bringing that up. All right, next is Tri-Town Landing update. All right, we have some flow test results scanned to board. Okay, so these are the results of the flow tests. You've got the email, which you can read. It sounds like the flow tests went well, I think is how I would summarize this. September 9th, okay. Purposes, so the testing was done September 9th. The purpose of the site visit was to conduct a water flow test using hydrants at the site. This is important for fire suppression. The gauge hydrant is located at the southwest front corner of building 3 adjacent to the service road. The flow hydrant is located at the southeast front corner of building 3 adjacent to the access drive to the parking lot. The static pressure was 130 psi. The residual was 120 psi. Associated flow of 1,300 gallons per minute. These results were similar to the tests conducted by McKenzie Engineering November 6, 2012, after upgrades were made to the water supply network. Static 130, residual 100, associated 1174. So I guess that was, as expected, the results were good. So any questions about that?
Nope. None. Thank
you. Okay. So middle school, high school project, no report. Highfield Village, no report. Emerald Place, no report. Force Corp, no report. Chase and Pleasant Solar, no report. Whitetail, no report other than what we talked about. 90 West Townsend Road, notice of intent to sell. I don't know if the thing that was labeled this in our distribution was not actually this.
Okay.
So although I think there was an intent to send it to the board, mm-hmm. something else was sent by accident.
Okay.
Yes.
And this is for your information, and it'll probably be coming back from the town administrator for your opinion. It's a change of, I think, of use.
Okay, for agricultural
for
property,
agriculture.
61B?
Mm-hmm, exactly.
Okay, I'll send this down. Let me just take a quick peek.
Okay.
61B is forestry. 61A is ag.
Ah, okay. Good call. Ooh. Is this the tree farm, the Christmas tree farm?
I'm not sure.
It looks like it to me.
Okay.
Okay. Sorry, I'll fork this over. Do you happen to see what it's going for here? $70,000. How many acres do you have to know?
Can't be too much for $70,000.
Should be on the assessor's card that you were on.
If it's going to stay in ag,
all the information on it.
I think it's like 4,000 versus 20,000. I'm not positive.
Which one's the assessor's
card? Oh, it is proposed to stay in ag.
Well, if it's going to stay in ag, it would make sense that it would be a larger parcel for a smaller amount.
So that's the building that's on site, and here's area.
Total land area, yeah. 11.4 acres.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. What's the total fin area?
Probably staying egg.
All right, thanks.
Power lines.
What's that?
There's power lines that go through there.
Mm.
That's probably why it's $70,000.
Some why what now?
That's probably why the price isn't higher for 11 acres.
Ah, gotcha. Can you look at that map? It doesn't abut town land, does it? What's parcel 28? Probably not.
What's the address?
No, probably not.
That's on Northfield. That's probably the golf course.
No, it's...
Or Highfield Village, maybe? No?
No, it's the other side of Route 13.
Oh, okay. Oh, that's maybe Dix? Hmm.
Dix is here.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Oh, it's that farm that just sold, probably. Actually, I don't know if that's the tree farm.
No, it's not a tree farm.
It's the other side of the road. Okay.
What's the address?
90 West Thompson Road.
90 West Thompson?
A lot of guessing. All right. Well, we're looking at that. We'll go through a few other items here. I think we're pretty near done. So regarding the scenic roads for Flat Hill and Northfield that we've been discussing, a letter was sent to the Historical Commission on September 9th, and we haven't heard back yet.
Yeah, we were asking them for just a write-up as far as historic qualities of those roads to aid in our argument as far as why they deserve to be scenic roads.
Exactly.
Other than that, is there anything we have to do on our end as far as getting that ready to go on town meeting?
You mean
So if we want to put something on the warrant for town meeting to mm-hmm. designate Northfield Road and Flat Hill Road
mm-hmm.
is
scenic roads.
Scenic roads. Probably we need to have a public hearing before town meeting.
You probably would.
What do we need? Who could write up the The bylaw, is that going to go in our protective bylaw, or where does that actually go exactly?
I think it's a general bylaw that you have as a scenic, and what you end up designating. I was looking at it today because someone else had a question regards to Flat Hill Road being a scenic road.
Okay.
And I looked it up today, and it's a general bylaw. So, and you guys have a form where people can come forward and designate a scenic road.
Yep.
So, I mean, where you're the authority in designating with the Historic Commission,
yep,
a scenic road. So, I'm not sure if there's a public hearing requirement, but I can look into that.
Okay.
Because, yeah, I mean, we already have Leominster Road and Lancaster Ave, scenic roads. All you should have to do is
copy
and paste the name, I think. So.
Yeah. Right. What are the approval requirements for that? Is it majority of town meeting or
what? I'm not quite sure. I'd have to look into that more. The last community I worked for didn't have any scenic roads at all, so this is new to me too. So I can look into that and get back to you for next meeting.
If we could at least get a copy of our scenic road bylaw as it is, so yes, we know what we're doing.
Right.
Yeah, and then just understanding that process would be great.
Yeah.
I'm sorry to bother you with that, but
no,
that would be awesome.
No, not at all. I mean, you definitely want to know about the process of doing this, especially, you know, moving forward in the future. So, all right, let me do that for you guys.
Okay, so zoning bylaw design to standards discussion, I think we're going to resume that on October 6th. And we're all going to read up on our
signed bylaws.
Signed bylaw.
Nathan, to answer your question before, parcel 19 and 39 are both town parcels.
Really?
Not the big one.
Let's see.
19 and 39?
39.
Interesting. That's interesting. So I guess I'd entertain it. I mean, I guess discussion-wise, I mean, personally, I would defer to open space and conservation.
Yep.
And any other thoughts discussion-wise on
Oh, are you thinking about importance as far as acquisition?
Yeah.
I don't think there would be much possible.
You just want to throw that on aerial for a second there?
Yeah.
Because I think, if my memory is correct, it is mostly power line.
You should be able to see it. But yeah, you're right. The power line does go right along there somewhere.
Unless the town wants to build a solar project there, that would be a Board of Selectmen thing. But yeah, I mean, I don't know if I presume that we could, if the town wanted to do that, they could use the right of refusal to do that. But yeah, as far as I'm concerned, I leave it to the discretion of Board of Selectmen, conservation, and open space. Exactly.
Yep.
Any motion in that regard?
I would wait on that.
Oh, okay. Not ready for that?
Yeah, I would wait until you get notification from the town administrator, and then make your recommendation then.
That's what I meant to say. I'm not entertaining any motions related to that right now.
Okay.
Okay. Thanks, Matt, for doing the research there. Okay, so the 250 Whalum Road, Whalum Luxury, it says ZBA continued in September 24th. Okay, I thought it was even later than that, but that's cool. Oh, it's September 24th. So there's going to be a public hearing regarding 250 Whalum Road on September 24th.
Wednesday.
On Wednesday.
Right.
Yeah, I think what's today? The
22nd.
22nd, yes, that would be this Wednesday. It'll be here in Town Hall on the second floor in this room. And that's to discuss the, okay, Notice is hereby given that ZBA will hold a public hearing on September 24th, 2014, 7 p.m. at Lunenburg Town Hall, second floor, Joseph Blatta Meeting Room, 17 Main Street, Lunenburg, Mass. Lunenburg Zoning Board will hear the petition of Whalum Road LLC, Gary B. Lord, and manager, 69 Mass Ave, Lunenburg, 01462. The property which is the subject to this case is located at 250 Whalum Road, Lunenburg, Mass, 01462, known as Whalum Luxury Apartments, Assessor's Map 91382. The applicant is seeking to modify the existing comprehensive permit to increase the number of units to 120 by constructing five apartment buildings on 41 acres of land located at 250 Whalum Road, Lunenburg, Mass. The Zoning Board of Appeals will consider authorizing the comprehensive permit 40B. If you wish to appear in support for or in opposition to the position, you may do so in person, by agent, or by attorney. Copies of the application may be inspected at town clerk's office or the zoning board office during normal business hours. Any thoughts or discussion on that topic? Okay, so members of the public are encouraged, if they're interested, to attend that meeting. Okay. Master planning economic development element. So just one comment on the Whalum Luxury Apartments. That is the development that we talked about for a significant amount of time in relation to our meeting last month, where we were discussing our housing production plan. So if anyone's interested in some discussion, that go to YouTube. Unfortunately I don't remember which date that meeting was. I think it was in August sometime.
And that was previously known as the Lunenburg Village.
And it's the project is a 40B project, and there is a affordable housing component, and it has some interesting implications for how we plan out our housing plan in Lunenburg and how it affects our zoning bylaws. And it's an interesting discussion we had at that meeting with a representative from the MRPC. So anyone interested, check that out on YouTube.
Put affordable in the name too. Affordable luxury apartments.
Affordable and luxury. Yeah, actually, yeah. I mean, it's a pretty interesting plan. If you have a chance, it's probably posted on the ZBA site, or maybe it's on one of the town websites. But
I actually do have a comment on that.
Sure.
I believe that when we had the representative from MRPC to come in and talk to us about the 40B aspects, my recollection was that if there was at least 25% affordability aspect, our rental unit would be 100% towards our number.
That's right. So both the market rate units and I think he's proposing here.
There'd be 30.
120. So 30 would be affordable, which means that they would be priced at a rate that's set by the state, which is lower than what might normally be in a market rental environment. And they would be available to families, I believe, making somewhere around $55,000 a year combined family income and under. And there's a formula which determines what that number is. And then that would be 30 units like that. And then there would be 90 units, which would just be market rate rental units. And what you're saying is true. So Lunenburg has what they call a subsidized housing inventory, and all those units would count towards that number. If that number gets to be 10% of our housing stock, then even 40B projects need to comply with the town's bylaws, basically. So that's the advantage of meeting your SHI number.
My recollection was that we can deny 40Bs altogether as long as we're keeping up with our minimum, which is 0.5% per year.
You can deny them as long as they don't comply with your existing bylaws, basically. I mean, you can deny projects. The thing about normally before, you know, I don't think you can deny them if they meet all your zoning
bylaws. They would have to submit as something that was usable under the subdivision control, under our subdivision regulations.
Right.
Right. Not a 40B.
Yeah, I'm not as familiar with the distinction.
Is the applicant proposing to do the 25%, or are you just saying that would get us...
Well, if it's a 40B project, it has to be, I believe, 1 in 4.
I think it's a 40B.
It is a 40B, and I believe they are planning to do the 3-1 split, but that would be something to pay attention to at the meeting. When I last I checked, they were planning to do the 3-1 split. You can actually do a 9-1 split as well, but that changes the nature of the affordable units. It lowers the it decreases the income eligibility threshold.
And Sam Lawton at MRPC will soon have a draft for you guys to review on the 6th. Of the housing production plan, which will break all these numbers down for you and make it, you know, make things a lot clearer. So great. Something to look forward to.
Yeah, it'll be great. Mm-hmm. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
So last thing I'll mention about the plan, it's an interesting plan to look at. There's, I forget what it, there's like 4 or 5 buildings, and there's quite a bit of enclosed parking provided on the site as well. It's definitely, if folks have interest in the project, they should check out that ZBA meeting. Anything further on Whalum Street? No? Okay. Moving on. Master Planning Economic Development Element for October 20th. On October 20th, we're going to discuss the Master Planning Element, Economic Development Element that was prepared for us by the MRPC in collaboration with us. And our goal is to get that reviewed by the town boards, then have a public hearing on it, and then incorporate it into our master plan. And so we're at our 10/20, at our October 20th meeting, we're going to meet with, we've invited other boards to meet with us. So far, the Sewer Commission has responded. They will attend. They're the only respondent so far. And so that's the update on that. 40 Leominster Shirley Road, no report. Any comment on the economic development element stuff? Okay. Notices and communications, cover sheet scanned to the board. Okay, so did you guys receive in your email the CPTC fall 2014 schedule?
Yes.
Yep.
Okay.
There's some here if you need
There's
them.
Some here if you would like them. And she's highlighted, actually, we got this in email, and it highlights the two top choices that were discussed by our board here, creating master plans and planning with community support.
And you can go online and sign up for those. I imagine, or you can have Marjorie do it. I imagine you probably have earmarked money for you to go to attend workshops and whatnot. So.
Okay, great. And that's okay. The Community Citizen Planner Training Collaborative is what CPTC is. Mm-hmm. Any discussion on that one?
We went to the site plan review one last year, right?
I remember going to that.
Oh, that's being taught by Paul Bobrowski, but that's not Bobrowski. Is that that's not the Bobrowski that did the okay.
I don't think so.
Nope, it was very useful. I hope this next ones are as well. I'm sure they will be.
I highly recommend the spring one where you can attend up to 4 workshops in one day. Mm-hmm. It's highly educational.
So. Yeah. No, they tend to be very eye-opening.
Yes.
Which one was that?
CPTC puts on a spring... what's the word I'm looking for? They put on a spring... I'd say like a seminar. So they have, I think, 2 sessions. Actually, it's 3 sessions. I'm sorry, I take that back. So you can do up to 3 of these types of workshops they have listed here. And they hold it at Holy Cross College in Worcester. Mm-hmm. And it's an all-day event where they have a breakfast, brunch, and a lunch. And so you can take up to 3 of these workshops. There are usually, you know, in the fall they hold them in different places, but in the spring you can, you know, go to one place and, you know, pick and choose whatever seminar you want to go to or session.
Excellent.
Yeah, so look for it. It's usually in March. I went this past March.
Very good.
Yep.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Excellent. Anything else about the... CPTC. All right, so meeting schedule. Our next meeting currently scheduled is October 6, 6:30 to discuss the housing production plan and village district bylaw. Any A&R coming in tonight could be endorsed at this meeting, as October 20th meeting will take the board past the 21-day statutory limit. So I think the only A&R we got today was
this one.
Was the one here that Oakland Road that would have been signed tonight.
Marjorie thought there may have been another one, but they were no show. So okay. I think that's why she put that note in there. And gotcha. I wasn't sure if she was 100% if you were going to endorse this tonight.
Well, that's good to know.
Yeah.
Okay, so any public comment? All right, board comment. Member issues. Okay, so I would take a motion to, can we sign that after we adjourn? I would take a motion to adjourn and then sign the plans and conclude for the evening.
So moved.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.